Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's presentation on narcotic drugs and psychoactive substances. Before I start, I would like to begin with a disclaimer saying above content is an overview of the Act and is discussed here for educational purposes only. And some of the content or the presentation may be misinterpreted on account of poor legal knowledge and ambiguity of legal content. And above content is not a complete briefing of the Act, hence it's cautioned not to use or refer the same in legal aspect. And it is recommended to all to refer the Act in detail for any further legal purposes. The educational objective is to find out the need for the NDPS Act and overview of the NDPS and more details on the prohibition and punishment with respect to the substances, medical treatment for consumption, and regarding the rules and regulations for the institutions or medical practitioners, which have been updated recently. So the overview of introduction, a brief background, act per se, and some of the recent amendments. To begin with, the introduction. So as we know that drug is a major social evil, and the drug use and trafficking activities have been in a increasing trend. So drug use and drug trafficking is rampant not only in India, all over the world. And it is known to destroy the social life and as well as various aspects of a person. And inflow of heroin and hashish has been a major increasing trend, especially in India because of the surrounding production areas, famously known as Golden Crescent of Iran, Afghanistan and Pakistan, and Golden Triangle of Burma, Laos and Thailand. Before beginning with the Indian background, I would like to start with the internationally. Right from the 1912, there has been an international convention on narcotic drugs, and there has been a regular revision of upgrading to bring a law for the control and regulation of this narcotics. In 1912, there was an opium convention, 1925, agreement on manufacturing and trade and use of prepared opium. 31, again the same thing, 36 for the suppression of illicit trafficking. 46 there was for the amendments until 1961, when the United Nations called for a convention for the control of narcotic drugs, and the convention was held under United Nations. So with respect to India, earlier there were a few acts like Opium Act, which was in 1857, later upgraded to 90 Opium Act in 1878, and Dangerous Drugs Act in 1930. These acts were mainly with respect to opium, and Dangerous Drugs Act had dealt a little bit with the cannabis and cocaine. However, there was no mention about the cultivation or any specific punishments with respect to cannabis or cocaine. And other drugs were partially covered in this in the Drugs and Cosmetic Acts 1940. So as I said, there was no mention of cultivation of cannabis, and maximum punishment with respect to opium was just 3 years with or without a fine. But with respect to cannabis, India had no legislation for narcotics as well as cannabis until 1985. The older one, which was Indian Hemp Drugs Commission, 1893, they found that the cannabis was in a regular use and moderate use was acceptable as per that law. And cannabis was legally sold until 1985. So until 1961, United States began to campaign for a worldwide law against all drugs. And India resisted the same till for the 25 years until they succumbed to the law or to were pressurized and accepted it in 1985. So as a signatory to the UN 1961 Single Convention, India was obliged to eradicate culturally ingrained patterns of drug use, including those involving cannabis and opium. So whatever has been done as a part of this act is mainly in convention to this law. And before this, India had the laws with respect only to the trade and revenue collection. So only after the 1961 convention, they have gone ahead and regulated for the control and other purposes. So the Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act was passed by Indian Parliament in 1985. It came into effect from 14 November 1985. The act consists of six chapters, and the responsibility of this control is in a central function, is carried out through Ministry of Finance and Department of Revenue. So NDPS Act, it's 61 of 1985, as I said, came in force on 14 November. And frequently there have been several changes as needed. So the first amendment was done in 1989, followed by 2001 and 2011, 14, and recent one was in 2015. Just a brief outline of the various chapters. The first chapter deals with mainly the preliminary definitions. Chapter 2 with the various authorities and officers concerned with the Act. 2A is the National Fund for Control of Drug Abuse. Chapter 3 with the prohibition, control and regulation. Fourth one with the offenses and various penalties. And lastly, the procedure to carry out the Act. So the Act is mainly to consolidate and amend the law which is relating to the narcotic drugs and to make a stringent provisions for control and regulation of operations relating to the narcotic drugs, and also to provide for the forfeiture of property derived from or used in illicit traffic in narcotic drugs, and lastly to implement the provisions of the International Convention. And it is applicable to all Indians and also to all Indians outside India, as well as all people on ships and aircrafts which are registered in India. And it shall come into force as per the date by the central government through the notification in Official Gazette or different state as the states start using the Act. And the power to add or omit a drug in the list belongs to the central government. So whenever there is an information and evidence of any particular substance or the nature and effect of it, or there is any substance which has a scope for abuse, so such an substance is added to the list. Or if there is a modification or any provision provided by the International Convention, then the substances can be included. So before we begin with the details of that, I would like to start with the definitions. So first one is the psychotropic substances. It's any substance, whether it's natural or synthetic or preparation of such substance or material included in the list of psychotropic substances specified in the schedule. As such, there are currently around 80 to 84 substances included in the schedule. Coca leaf is a leaf of the coca plant, except a leaf from which all agnonin, cocaine and any other agnonin alkaloids have been removed. Addict means any person who is dependent on narcotic drugs or psychoactive substances. And narcotic drug means coca leaf, cannabis, opium, poppy straw, and includes all manufactured goods. Manufactured drugs like coca derivatives, medicinal cannabis, opium derivatives, as well as poppy straw concentrate. And opium derivatives includes all medicinal opium, prepared opium, morphine, codeine, anything which contains more than 0.2% of morphine. A small quantity and commercial quantity. This is the guidelines given by them based on which punishment is enlisted. So commercial quantity is any quantity greater than the quantity specified. And similarly, the small quantity as specified, I'll be giving the quantity details further. Other meanings like cannabis hemp, here the cheras, which is a separated resin obtained from cannabis plant, and also includes a concentrated preparation like hashish oil or liquid. And ganja is flowering or fruiting tops of the plant. Cannabis plant here is of the genus cannabis. And coca derivatives is a crude cocaine extract from the leaf. Controlled substance, any substance which is used in manufacture of narcotic or any other psychoactive substance. Narcotic drug, as said earlier. Opium is coagulated juice of the opium poppy. Opium poppies the full of the belongs to the plant of species Papaver somniferum. And poppy straw is all part of the plant except the seeds. So moving to the second chapter, which deals with the authorities and officers. Mainly the central government has to take measures for preventing and combating the abuse of as well as illicit trafficking. Enforcement, there are various agencies which have been empowered to undertake the Act, which includes Department of Customs and Central Excise, the Directorate of Revenue Intelligence, Central Bureau of Narcotics, CBI, Border Security Force, as well as State Police and Excise Departments. And National Control Bureau was further included in the part of this Act in 1986. And currently there are five centers, with the headquarters being at Delhi. And also in 1989, there was a further amendment and National Fund for Control of Drug Abuse was introduced or included. So which the main objective of which is to combat the illicit trafficking, abuse of drugs and preventing drug abuse, to carry out identification, treating and facilitating, rehabilitating addicts, as well as to carry out various public education with respect to the narcotic drugs, and also for the supply for medical purpose and to set for the rules and regulations to handle the same. Going to the third chapter, which is prohibition, control and regulations. So here the minimum quantity is for amphetamine 2 grams, commercial quantity is 50 grams, buprenorphine again it's 1 gram and commercial quantity 20 grams, hashish small quantity belongs 100 grams and commercial quantity is 1 kg, cocaine is 2 grams and 100 grams as commercial, codeine is 10 grams and 1 kg, diazepam it is 20 grams and 500 grams for the commercial, ganja 1 kg for as a small quantity and 20 kg for commercial, heroin is 5 grams and 250 grams for commercial, ecstasy is 0.5 and 10, methamphetamine is 2 grams and 250 grams, and mandrax is 20 grams and 500 grams, morphine 5 grams is small quantity and 250 grams is commercial, and poppy straw is 1 kg for small quantity and commercial quantity. However, there is a controversial whether there is a direct extract or the purified or unpurified form is not very clearly mentioned in the law. So with respect to the punishment, so any offense of production or manufacture, sale, purchase, transport, whether it's an interstate or export of interstate or use of drugs, as well as production of poppy straw, opium poppy and opium use, as well as illegal import to India or export from India. For all these purposes, the punishment remains the same. With a small quantity, there's a rigorous imprisonment up to 6 months or fine up to 10,000 or both. More than small quantity but less than the commercial quantity, the imprisonment term lasts from 10 years to or fine up to 1 lakh. Commercial quantity, it is from 10 to 20 years and fine from 1 to 2 lakhs. The fine can vary depending on the other situations as per the law. Coming to other, which is with respect to our patients or consumption of drugs. So cocaine, morphine, heroin consumption, there is a rigorous imprisonment up to 1 year or fine up to rupees 20,000 or both. For other drugs, it's 6 months of term and fine of 10,000. But there is a immunity for this kind of patients where addicts volunteering for treatment, they enjoy the immunity for prosecution. So the immunities for drug offenses include whenever there is addicts are charged with consumption of drugs or with offenses involving small quantities, they will be immune from prosecution if they volunteer for de-addiction. And this immunity can be withdrawn if the person does not undergo complete treatment. Or in case of legal, if he is found guilty, he can be sent for detoxification or de-addiction setup, which is recognized by the government, with the bond to appear before the court within 1 year. And after the treatment, court may consider release with or with, without sureties. With respect to juvenile offenders, the same juvenile offender that is below 18 years of age will be governed by the Juvenile Justice Act, and Narcotics Act doesn't apply to them. And whereas other offenders in case of persons who are involved in carrying out this act are immune to it, diplomats are immune to it. Other offenses like cultivation of cannabis, coca plants, rigorous imprisonment up to 10 years and fine up to 1 lakh. And again, embezzlement of opium by licensed farmers remains 10 to 20 years term and fine of 1 to 2 lakhs. External dealings, similarly, 10 to 20 years and fine of 1 to 2 lakhs. If there is a repeat offense, earlier in 1985 laws, it was half time the minimum punishment to half time the maximum punishment. However, it has been amended and increased to 1.5 times the punishment of the offense, and also death penalty can be included in this. So death penalty for certain offenses, like if there is a repeated offense, or even in if he is Indian, carry out any such illegal act and is convicted by any court outside India, will be dealt as the same verdict as held in outside India. And there are certain provision where there is, it doesn't fit into act, and the punishment for offense with no punishment is provided. In such case, 6 months or fine, or includes both. So as I said, there are some factors which impose a punishment higher than the minimum term or minimum fine. So in case of use or threat of use of violence or arms by the offender, if a person is holding a public office and takes advantage of that position, if minors are used in trafficking or usage or in crimes, or if they carry out in an educational or social facilities belonging to any organized or criminal group, and if they're involved in other illegal activities, in such scenario, the fine amount and the term might increase. So there is a special courts which have been especially meant to carry out this act in order to have a speedy trials. It's usually headed by a single judge with the minimum qualification of sessions judge or additional sessions. All offenses under this act are cognizable, and no offense of two or more will be released on bail, except if the public prosecutor feels that the concerned person was not involved into carrying out the activities or is unlikely to go and continue the act. If enacted before setting up of the court, then the respective court shall see the or handle the case. In case if the offense is carried out by the whole of by the company, then all the members which are involved in the company or working are deemed guilty, unless the act has been done without the knowledge of some of the employers. And the power of issuing this warrant or seizing any activity depend or lies on the metropolitan magistrate, either first class or second class magistrate, and any officer which is gazetted rank of Department of Customs, Excise, Revenue or Narcotics, and power to enter any place and search or seizure of the property and arrest without warrant or authorization lies only with a superior officer above a constable or any sepoy. Duty of landholder, is a mention of this section, where if a person's land is being utilized to cultivate or carry out this illegal activities, then the duty lies on the landholder to inform. In case if he doesn't inform, then he'll be held as a guilty for the same. So this was the law as per the 1985. Since they found it was a weaker law, there was no clear-cut guidelines regarding the definitions, and as well as for the person who was consuming. So there was an amendment in 2011, and they added some new definitions like central government factories. A more specific definition of the commercial and small quantity was given. They broadened the definition of property. So the illegal property which was acquired directly, indirectly, through the or with the usage of the money gained through illegal trafficking. Punishment to person who consumed was eased in this, and given a provision for treatment, and provision of possessing or transferring any property or concealment also was found guilty as per this amendment. Enhancement of punishment was increased from half to 1.5 times. And power to regulate poppy straw concentrate. So earlier there was a provision for the state also to regulate, which was shifted back to the central. There was a proper guidelines put forth for the procedure of disposal of all the quantities being seized. And there was a loophole in this where the notification by the concerned authority, the duration was 180 days. So there was one of the drawback is during 180 days, there was a concern that the concerned officials might misuse the authority. Competent authorities include the collectors of customs or central excise, and which was changed to commissioner of customs or central excise. And there was also a tribunal which was headed by a chairman to carry out the various act. So advantages of this amendment as well as the including the previous act was there was shortcomings of the bill, like definitions which were not very clear were made clear in this act. The ease over the restrictions on the use of narcotic drugs was introduced. Licensing power was transferred to a single authority, that is the central government. And acknowledgement of the need for treatment and management was given in this act. The shortcomings was, again, as I said, the commercial and small quantity still remained. Definitions were not very clear with respect to different substances. And concerns over the reduction of punishment for consumption, so which was reduced from 1 year to 6 months. And as well as there was given a provision to avoid the case if they agreed for de-addiction, and avoid, in order to avoid misuse, the notification period, they wanted to reduce it to 90 days from 180 days. But again, it was a shortcoming in this act. Death penalty was changed to may be punishable with death. So earlier there was a strict of death penalty with respect to repeat offenders and all. But here it was removed and it was made may be punishable. And in order to avoid undue harassment from the authorities, still that provision was not taken care in this amendment. So later on, they moved on to the next amendment, which was in 2014. Here, again, the definitions were further cleared. The central government factories meant any factories which in which the state, the central government had a 51% of stake. Till now, there was no mention about the essential narcotic drugs like morphine and anything for the medical purposes. So it was in this act they introduced the essential narcotic drugs, as well as availability of the drugs and psychoactive substances for medical and scientific use as well. And the slight change in the definition of poppy straw, where the words like except poppy straw produced from plants from which no juice has been extracted through lancing was introduced. Punishments for all till now, the small quantity was 6 months. It was doubled to 1 year. And again, repeat offense was made to 1 and 1.5 times. Notification, which was a shortcoming in 2011 amendment, from 180 days, it was brought down to 90 days. And again, the property by all means, here the by all means include directly with the amount used to procure the substance or the profits through the substance in involving in concealment and abatement, as well as earning the property or handing over the property to different people. So all those substances or properties were included into this act. Further, there was a shortcomings with regard to the essential narcotic drugs with respect to medical institutes. So which was taken care in last amendment or the recent one, 2015. They gave a new definitions for the licensed chemist, licensed dealer, medical institution, prescription, registered medical institution or practitioner. This amendment has taken care most of the things which belongs or which is in need for a medical practitioner or any institute who wants to carry out pain and palliative care and opioid dependence treatment. So the provision here is the any licensed the chemist can obtain a license with a form given effort in the act with the application of for 5,000 rupees. Within 30 days of application, the license it will be issued, and if rejected, the reasons will be mentioned. And the certain centers where they want to manufacture, they have to follow the strict Drugs and Cosmetic Act rules. And they have to give a notice 1 month before stopping the production. And if they want to restart, 15 days prior intimation has to be given. In case if there is an excess or expiry, the destruction has to be carried out, or the disposable has to be carried out in presence of a committee and within 30 days of the specified date. And in case of transport guidelines, they have to carry a triplicate confinement note. One has to be retained with the manufacturer. Two has to be carried by the person who is taking the consignment. The details have to be maintained at least for 2 years. And in case if there is a bill, invoice or signature of the concerned authority, then they need no need to carry out that triplicate note. In case if somebody is transporting the medicines by post, courier or rail or road, then they have to use only one means, that is by government post, that is registered post. And details of the consignor and consignee contents, the registration of the parcel, their addresses has to be mentioned in the post. This is with respect to possessing any essential narcotic drugs by any medical practitioner in case of in his hospital. So it's meant only for use in practice and not for sale or distribution. And it should not be not more than the specific quantity as mentioned. And the quantity, the permission is given only for 3 years, and before 60 days of the expiry of the 3 years, they have to renew the license. So the quantity is 500 milligrams for morphine, codeine so and so. The registered medical profession may be prohibited from the license if he violates any of the law, if he is convicted under any of the act with respect to NDPS, and he self abuses or any reasons where he is rendered unfit to hold the license. And whenever a doctor is prescribing, the specific guidelines have to be followed. They have to specify the date, name, address both of the clinic as well as the patients, registration details, quantity of the drug given, and they cannot self-prescribe for themselves. With respect to the institutes, they have specified specific guidelines for this, and persons like pilot of aircraft or captain of ship, they can have certain quantity in case of emergency. Ambulance in charge or first aid kit can carry certain quantity, and every registered representative should maintain the details for a period of 2 years. So with respect to a medical institute, at least one registered practitioner, it's an MBBS or a dental, or who has undergone training in pain or palliative treatment or replacement in opioid dependence for an institute to be registered. So when a particular doctor of such a caliber is registered, so that institute is called as a registered institute. Certificate to be issued within 60 days of application. It has to a period for 3 years, renewal 60 days before expiry. If in case if there is a change of constitution of recognized institute, the earlier license is valid for 90 days, and license can be cancelled if it is found that it is used for non-medical purposes or if there is a breach of any condition or the law. And designated medical practitioner, there will be a one particular medical practitioner under whom this license will be issued. If there are many eligible practitioners, then one person will be made in charge. And if that person handovers the license to somebody else or the registration to somebody else, it has to be intimated within 7 days. Again, the duty of the designated doctor is to maintain a register, patient-wise details, record of the receipts and disbursements of drugs, preserve the records for 2 years, and he has to file a return of the details of all the above before 31st March of the calendar year. And in case if he wants to leave or cancel his registration, he has to give a notice that it is prior to the same. Estimates of requirement, this is to be done before 30th of November. In case if the need is more, then it can be revised and done before 31st of August. In case if there is an excess of medication, so it has to be discarded as per the rules under supervision of an concerned authority. And patients, in case if he returns the medications which is left over, will be considered as a receipt by the doctor, which has to be maintained again and reported. So lastly, the home care treatment, it is patients are permitted to carry the quantity as specified by the doctor. And one odd and difficult thing for opioid treatment of opioid dependence is that home care treatment should not be provided for treatment of opioid dependence. To summarize, Act is in regard to International Convention on Drugs 1961. The rules are more stricter and severe for better control and regulations. Terms are more clear and unambiguous. Punishment has been made severe in all aspects of default of law. There's a provision for medical treatment in case of addicts. More clarity on license, essential narcotic use and disposal. Measures have been taken to avoid some of the harassment from the authorities. Thank you.